Good morning and welcome to the fourth meeting in 2021 of the Finance and Constitution Committee. We have apologies this morning from Jackie Bailey, and James Kelly will be our substitute, and I welcome James back to our committee. The only item on our agenda today is to take evidence on our budget scrutiny from two panels of witnesses, and I warmly welcome our first panel of witnesses to the meeting and thank you for providing written submissions. Our first two are Mary Spowage, who's the Deputy Director of the Fraser Allender Institute, and Dr. Liz Cameron, who's the Director and Chief Executive of the Scottish Chambers of Commerce. The plan is to go straight to questions. And if I could begin with a question for Mary Spowage. Mary, can I begin with the mysterious world of the fiscal framework? The Scottish Fiscal Commission are forecasting a Scottish-specific economic shock, but they believe the outlook for the Scottish GDP and UK GDP are broadly similar. And most of the difference between the forecasts for Scotland and the OBR's UK forecast is likely to be accounted for by the fact that the OBR November 2020 forecast were before the current lockdown, and so look a bit more optimistic view of the prospects for the UK economy in 2021 than the SFC are talking about now. Are you able to give us any explanation to the committee about why the SFC's income tax forecast is much higher for Scotland than the OBR forecast for England? Indeed, the income tax net position for 2021-22 has increased from 155 million in February 2020 to 475 million in January 2021. And that means obviously the Scottish Government were better off by around 320 million, which is as the SFC point out, is a significant increase in expected funding available. Should we not have therefore been expecting the opposite, given the Scottish Fiscal Commission's economic forecast is more pessimistic than the OBR economic forecast? And I realise, obviously, we'll have another forecast from the OBR in March. It's a long question, Mary, but it's a complicated area, the fiscal framework, and I'm just trying to make sure that everyone understands as best we can what the implications are. Thanks, Mary. Over to you.
Yeah, so as you say, the Scotland-specific economic shock that's been forecast, which is the sort of the year-on-year figures up to the quarter three of 2021, are really specifically on that issue that is a fluke of timing, mostly. So essentially, given the poorer economic outlook that, that anybody, I think, forecasting would have between the end of November and January, that the outlook for 2021 is poorer than would have been the case in November. In November, obviously, there was lots of optimistic vaccine news. Things were looking like they might start to recover in early 2021. But after that, we've had the new variants and the significant lockdowns that have been imposed across the UK. So I think in general, anybody doing a forecast in January would have been more pessimistic than November. And therefore, the trigger for the Scotland-specific economic shock isn't a surprise, and obviously the terms of the fiscal framework are very clear that it sort of doesn't matter that there are these differences of timing, that if the conditions are met, that this shock is triggered, therefore the additional flexibilities that are there for the next 3 years are now in place, and they are in place even if that shock is essentially removed by the OBR forecasts in early March. The more complex issue is the one about how this feeds through to income tax forecasting. I think having looked at the SFC material in detail, unfortunately there's not a simple or single explanation for that seeming divergence or seeming inconsistency. I guess some of the things I would point out are that the relationship that we would traditionally expect between changes in output or GDP and what's happening to the labour market aren't happening right now. So there are a lot of breakdowns in those relationships because of things like the furlough scheme and different things to protect employment, which means the way that GDP falls would feed through to falls in the in employment and wages aren't necessarily happening. So our understanding of what those relationships are, given the continuation of the furlough scheme, and of course since the OBR produced a forecast that has been extended for a further year, further month, sorry, which is one of the things that the SFC point out. So we don't really understand exactly how the falls in output are going to manifest themselves into unemployment at the moment. And at the moment, though, both the OBR and the SFC are expecting that unemployment will peak at a similar level. Also, since the OBR produced the forecast, the SFC have changed slightly the data that they're using to determine earnings, which is the main reason that the income tax forecasts are different. And have switched to using the RTI data. There was a further quarter of that data between the OBR forecast being published and the SFC forecast being published. Obviously, the main difference that happens for income tax growth is earnings growth. And you can see in the SFC report, they're pointing out that there's still a levels difference between Scotland and the UK, and they're assuming a degree of catching up, although that most of the gap will persist over the forecast horizon. So there are a number of different things that the SFC point out, none of which are sort of completely satisfactory. But a lot of the uncertainty is around the fact that both the forecast and the BGA have been revised down hugely. You know, so the BGA has been revised down by £1 billion, and the forecast has been revised down by 600 to 700 million pounds. These are large changes in the forecast. And when you have movements in these two very large numbers of such a degree, I suppose it isn't surprising that you have some of these inconsistencies. As the SFC's job is to produce the best forecast they can of Scottish income tax revenues, the OBR have a different view, are using different data at a different time, have access to other data about the UK that the SFC don't have for Scotland, and are coming up with a slightly different conclusion about earnings growth overall. But I understand that that's not hugely satisfactory answer for the committee.
Well, I also understand that, Mary, it's probably the only answer you can give at this stage because we are living in such unpredictable times, and the level of sensitivity in any forecasting at this stage is going to be significant. But Richard Hughes also told the committee last week, Richard Hughes from the OBR, that is, that although there are differences in the sectorial composition of the rest of the UK and the Scottish economies, they are almost entirely offsetting in relation to the impact of the virus on the economy and income tax receipts, as shown in both the sectoral GDP data and in real-time information from PEYE systems. Given this, again, it's difficult for us who are a bit more steeped in this process to understand why the income tax net position has increased from 155 million to 475 million for 2021. So goodness knows how difficult it is for those who might be observing from the outside. But I don't know if you could give us any more of your view of what's going on here in that regard.
Yeah, I mean, as I said, there has been more data about Scotland since the OBR produced a forecast on RTI, and obviously the outturn for 2019 on our RTI wage growth was higher than was expected last year. In terms of the sectoral differences and kind of the experience of the pandemic, I wouldn't want to overplay what we know already. I mean, obviously, broadly, the experience of the economy and the published data, it looks like it's tracking the UK fairly closely. But to some extent, that's down to the way things are measured in the very short term. So I don't think we understand exactly how things are playing out differently in Scotland to a huge degree of detail just yet. I think we've made this point before, that I think our understanding of exactly what's happened to the economy during the period of the pandemic is going to probably evolve over the next couple of years as we get more and better data about the experience of companies throughout 2020. But I would agree that it's really hard to it's not easy to explain simply why there's differences in the forecast. And I look forward to seeing how the SFC explain it next week, and maybe in a more easy to digest form. I suppose some of the change in their earnings forecast, which has obviously deteriorated since February, it just hasn't deteriorated to the same degree as the OBR forecast. They've explained it in terms of lower public sector pay growth than they had assumed at that point. And obviously there may be some differences in terms of the expectation for public sector pay growth in the UK and Scotland, for example. I don't know if that's a factor. It's not really covered in the report in great detail, just that that's a factor for the deterioration between February 2020 and the latest forecast. So, given the higher proportion of public sector in Scotland, perhaps that's a factor, but I'm not sure. It's not clear from the report. But it's all when you have these large numbers moving around by such large amounts, it isn't that surprising to me that these are both shifting so much, that you get these things where the BGA and the forecasts are off to this sort of degree. Albeit that the budgetary consequences are significant, and this is one of the issues around the way that the framework operates, and it sort of highlights the risks in sort of the budget envelope overall, relying on the views of two different forecasters at two different points in time, based on two different sets of data and two different sets of judgments.
Yeah, I'm just going to go to Murdo Fraser in a minute, Mary, but that was very helpful in signalling up some of the areas that we might want to prod the Scottish Fiscal Commission with next week. So, Murdo Fraser, over to you. And thank you, Mary.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to Liz Cameron and Mary Spurridge. I've got a couple of questions. I wonder if I could start with Liz Cameron. I was reading the Chamber of Commerce submission in relation to the budget, and clearly there's a focus there on the need for economic recovery and the need for business support. So can I ask you, what's your take on the budget announcements generally in relation to what's proposed for business support? Do they go far enough in your view, and what more needs to be done?
Okay, thank you very much, and good morning, Marjorie, and good morning, other colleagues. I was listening intently there to Mary's explanation, and I'm beginning to think I was a different planet, Mary, because I understand I'm not an economist, but I'm smiling, and you explained it very, very well. But I think that there's a number of other conditions that need to be taken into account, as you have said, Mary. And in particular, we've not mentioned in the focus on there was a lot of upfront output and upfront manufacturing, which took place towards the end of 2020, particularly from manufacturing and indeed from construction, because there was a lot of pre-planning and pre-stocking and exporting trends increasing over that last quarter, as businesses became very, very nervous about the EU exit date of 31st December. So there's been an absolute uploading in those last two quarters in 2020, which will skew the figures quite considerably. And if we manage to meet a 400% tax input in 2021, I would be absolutely delighted. I don't see that happening at all, but I'm not an economist, and I hope to be proven wrong. Marco, coming back to your question, yes, economic recovery plan. We've been calling for, and I know it's maybe not, I'm not sure it's something your remit or not, but we're quite clear that obviously health, vaccine, testing, they're absolute priority. So whatever I say, please caveat it on that basis. The health and safety of our communities are absolute priority. However, we've been calling for, businesses need right now a plan, an economic recovery plan that, albeit, we don't want grants. We actually want the ability to be able to begin to trade, albeit phased and in a safe manner. So therefore, we've been calling for nearly 4 months now for, can we see an economic development plan that we can contribute and design alongside our partners in government, and the public sector generally, so that we've got something running in parallel with the health crisis plan and an economic plan, because we need that, because we're not investing, we're having massive job losses and many, many planned. Because as we mentioned, the furlough, I thought Mary had a scoop there that said we're going to have furlough for another 12 months, but she quickly changed that. So it's being skewed right now, and we are going to be seeing massive job losses, So we need to have a confidence and a hope from a business perspective for our employees and our business owners to say, if X, Y, and Z happens, we are going to be looking at a potential phased reopening starting X, Y. That's what we need now. We recognise that that will change, may evolve on a daily basis, and that's fine. But some sort of tentative date on that economic recovery plan, that's first of all the exit out of this, and also how we are actually going to, in the short term, focus on business survival and business growth, and then in the medium term, how we're going to begin to grow our economy. That's missing, and in the absence of that, confidence, optimism, trade, investment are all in a disastrous position. So it's really, really quite important that happens. I come back to what did we like, what we didn't like. I think in terms of that economic recovery plan, what we did like was the announcement of the National Infrastructure Plan. You know, that's been one of the key tools in the box that government can create and create an environment for business to be able to look at that recovery. Now, what I would add is that, you know, yeah, like it, 1.5 billion 2025, 2026, is there any possibility? And I know there's constraints around the amount of money that the government can call down in any fiscal year, but is there a possibility that could be brought forward to really stimulate our economy quickly in Scotland, perhaps using funds from SNIB, perhaps using British Business Bank, can we get a bit of that money, perhaps using private sector investors? You know, that's a firm part of it. The intention is there, but what I'm seeing is, can we bring that forward? Because that will stimulate our economy very, very quickly. It was tried and tested before when we were in a previous recession. We're no longer just in a recession. We're actually in a situation where we've got a national, you know, a disaster in our hands. So, you know, if we can look at bringing that absolutely forward and making the case to do so, we would value that. In terms of the business support, this is all about reducing costs. And whilst we talked about furlough, yes, we want to extend it, but that's not the only game in town. We actually want to look at the Scottish Government budget and appreciating that this has been a very difficult budget to pull together in the absence of the UK budget in the beginning of March. But that said, there must be scenario planning, we would assume, going on in the Scottish Government now with regard to a what-if scenario. If we get X from UK Government, what are we going to spend that on? And having that open dialogue with business to make certain and designing new initiatives with business that really meet our needs. And you know, there's no reason why that should not have been done. Business support, what do we like? What landed quite well with us? We liked the reduction on the poundage rate. That was welcomed because the plans were to, in fact, increase that this year. Short-term extension of rates relief for specific sectors. Can I return to that, please? Commitment to small business bonus scheme, great. Additional financial support to economic development agencies by, I think it was 12%. Question I would have there, the devil's in the detail. How are we going to spend that money? How are we going to support business, particularly those in those sectors that really need it right now? Because you know what those sectors are. I don't need to be repeating that to you. So, you know, we'd like to know a wee bit more about how the focus of that spend is going to be supporting businesses and those really in need, whether they're self-employed or indeed whether they're employing 10, 20 or 2,000 people. The upskilling and reskilling, absolutely we welcome that because we've been calling upon that in our submission earlier on. And what I would say is that that's going to be one of the saviours, if we can get that right, on upskilling and reskilling our employees right now as we transform into new business models, particularly small and medium-sized businesses. And I would also say that that reskilling for individuals who are unfortunately made unemployed. So that's important. They talk about more funding for apprenticeships. We want that. We support the apprenticeship programme. We also would call upon a little bit more focus on Skills Development Scotland. That's our skills agency for Scotland. Looking at their budget, it seems to be a stay as it is. And on that basis, I'm not sure where the spend is going to be made there. The National Flexible Workforce Development Fund, fantastic. Flexible and workforce is the two key descriptives there. We like that. But It's never been independently evaluated. So we, again, we've been asking for that for some time. Let's make sure we are putting the our money in the funds in the right way. And if it's really, really successful, then let's look at the good parts of that and then look at the areas that we could be working more with our colleges and universities to make certain that that fund and the skills training is going in the right area. National Transitional Fund, again.
Liz, it's the community of Bruce. We'll cover a lot of that ground in other questions, but I'm just conscious
we've got. Okay, we like that. What we didn't like was the non-domestic rate stuff and some of the housing focus in the budget. And I'll come back to that, I'm sure, with other questions.
There'll be a chance. It's just that we've got slight time constraints on us today.
Sorry.
Wonder, you've got a follow-up here.
Yeah, thanks, Liz. I mean, that's really comprehensive, and I'm sure others will pick up some of the questions. I wonder if I could ask Barry Spowers a question quickly, if I may, Camilla. Looking at the budget as a whole, I mean, I think we see there's quite substantial increases, particularly in terms of the revenue spend from last year to this. According to SPICE, resource budget's up 11.2%, making this the highest budget in history of devolution. So I suppose my question for Mary is, would it be fair to say the age of austerity is over and we're now back into a period of inflation in public spending?
Well, it's certainly true what you said, that compared to the sort of heights of the 10-11 budget, which is often the comparison that's made, that this is the largest budget that there's been. So yes, that's certainly true. In terms of whether you think that means the age of austerity is over, I suppose that's dependent on how you define that. Obviously, there's been fairly large increases in the block grant in recent years, and healthy growth in the last few years compared to what we've been used to since the start of that austerity period, if I can call it that. So yes, it's certainly true that it's the largest budget since devolution in real terms.
Great. Okay, I'll leave it there, Camilla. Thanks very much.
Thanks, Murdo. We've got John Mason now, please. John.
Thanks very much, Bruce. And if I can start with Liz Cameron, you listed quite a number of things that where business would like support. And I'm just wondering how these would be paid for. Is the Chamber of Commerce and the businesses generally, will they be willing to pay a bit more tax in the medium to long term in order to pay for the extra support they're getting at the moment?
Interesting question, John. I think that, first of all, if you think about the rates relief, businesses have already given back grants that they've received over the 2020 because they didn't need them. And I think that was really good that they did that. And put that back into government pot to re-spend elsewhere. So I think that's worth making that point. In terms of raising, income tax, I've not asked members that specific question, but I'll give my own view on it. And I would say that obviously in the short to medium term, that would not be a welcomed option because we just simply can't afford to do that.
Would you accept that in the long term, if business is wanting support in a crisis, it needs to pay for it in the good times?
Well, I think that's recognised with some of the supermarkets giving back that money in the rates. But in terms of increasing taxation, I think that needs to be considered if the time is right and businesses, A, can afford to be able to pay additional tax, and B, what that money would be spent on. And I think that second point is quite important as well, because it's not just a matter of, raising tax, either personal taxation or business taxation. It's what we're going to be doing with that funding. If that funding is going to be spent...
What we're doing with the money is paying the furlough scheme. I mean, I accept that's at a UK level, but that's, we are spending the money now, which we do not have. So that's the answer, presumably, to your question, where the money would go. But if I can move on to something else, you mentioned a number of times in your report about city centres and,
yes,
that affects retail and offices and things. Do you think the city centres are going to go back to where they were, or do we really need to look at a different model for city centres, maybe with more residential accommodation?
I don't think city centres are going back to the model that we saw pre-pandemic. It's impossible to That will not happen. And we're already seeing the market is the market forces have changed that substantially in retailing and how we spend our money, how we shop, how we live, how we work. And so it will absolutely, I'm quite clear, it will not go back to same as usual. And I think that's where we need, and there's discussions going on right now about that redesign element. What would that look like? I think that, you know, for the city centre regeneration and for town centres as well, but mainly city centres here, they're absolutely the hub of, you know, big regional economies. So that redesign, and again, looking at what that would look like, and there's a lot of research being done right now and a lot of good reports being developed and devised by partnerships with local authorities and with chambers of commerce.
Okay, that's very helpful. Thanks very much. And if I could ask Mary Spowage, in the SPICE briefing, which you may have seen, I'm not sure, but in relation to capital expenditure, there does seem to be a reduction, and that seems to be largely because of financial transaction money from the UK being reduced. Can you explain that to me at all?
I noticed obviously that there is this large reduction in FTEs coming through. Generally these have been associated with schemes like Help to Buy and other things that the UK government, initiatives that the UK government have done. I'm afraid I'm not sure what the underlying reason for the reduction in FTEs is, but I mean, it is interesting. And I mean, I understand that perhaps some of this money in general would be used to capitalise National Investment Bank because it has to, the point about financial transactions is they have to go beyond the public sector boundary and essentially be lent out to the private sector. And in the past, the Scottish Government have used them to help capitalise housing associations and other initiatives like that. I'm not sure about the reason for the reduction in financial transactions.
Okay, I can ask other people about that. But is there a concern? Sorry.
They're not traditional capital spending. Obviously, they're more limited in terms of the flexibility you have around them.
So I suppose my question is that going to have an impact on capital spending? And if there is a reduction, that would not be great for the economy, would it?
Overall, government will have an important role in infrastructure spending to help the economy recover. So yes, any reduction in that capital spending is obviously concerning because really we would want to invest to help the economy to grow and capital investment is a key part of that.
Okay, thanks very much. Thanks, convener.
Thank you, John. Patrick Harvey, please.
Thank you, convener. It's pretty clear that the pandemic has, as well as the direct public health impact, has had an impact on our economy which is not evenly shared. There are some people who have been most vulnerable to the economic impact of COVID, in particular people with already low or precarious incomes. You know, certain types of businesses, certain sectors of businesses. But there are also those who've done very well. There are some businesses that have done very well. People whose incomes have remained protected have generally been spending less of that on their social lives and what have you. So there are some people who've been very, very sorely affected economically and some people who have been quite well protected and have done well. In questioning the Cabinet Secretary for Finance about this, case of should the budget seek to reverse the extra inequalities that COVID has caused, or is that for thinking about some years down the line? Kate Forbes emphasised stability. So can I ask you, Mary Spowage, first of all, what's your assessment overall, looking at things like public sector pay policy, which will see higher increases for higher earners in absolute terms, the council tax freeze, which will save more money for people in bigger properties, income tax thresholds, marginal, small amounts of money, but again, more money saved for higher earners, and the approach to non-domestic rates, which doesn't attempt to make any differentiation between those businesses that have profited from the pandemic and those that have suffered. What's your overall take on the progressivity of this budget. Is it a budget that's going to worsen the COVID inequalities that have been created or help to address them, or is it neutral?
That's a difficult one to answer, as I'm sure you're surprised I'm going to say. I mean, we do welcome the more detailed consideration of the differential impacts of the budget that was published with the budget this time. The additional detail is helpful, and obviously there was some focus on that in terms of community-led regeneration and employability and so on, which you could see potentially would be targeted at those who perhaps would be suffering most throughout the pandemic. But you know, you're right in terms of council tax freezes. You know, whilst council tax is a regressive tax and it's likely to form more income of those who earn the least as a proportion of their income, you know, you're going to get larger benefits to the freeze for those in larger properties. And obviously those on the lowest incomes are already likely to be benefiting from council tax reductions, so they're going to see a limited impact or benefit from the council tax freeze. Again, the changes in income tax obviously are mostly for the next financial year are mostly going to be down to the increase in the personal allowance, which is obviously a UK government policy. So not within the gift of the Scottish Government. The personal allowance increases benefit those right up the income distribution, and the lowest earners obviously are already out of tax and so don't benefit from that either. So I suppose overall it's probably a sort of steady as she goes sort of budget in terms of the real trying to address the real inequalities that have been, as you say, exacerbated by the pandemic.
If it's steady as she goes, there must be, I mean, if it's broadly neutral, you know, there must be something in there that's going to counterbalance the examples that I listed, which are regressive. So take public sector pay, for example. There'll be very high earners that are getting a £2,000 increase, very low earners that get £500. So that's going to increase pay inequality. You know, the changes on council tax and income tax thresholds and so on might be relatively small amounts, but they're both pushing in the same direction away from a progressive position. So is there something in there that I'm missing that achieves a position that is at best neutral in terms of progressivity? Is there something in there that's going to push in the other direction to counterbalance those examples I've mentioned?
Nothing that I can call to mind. I mean, the focus obviously on employment support and employability may be policies that could be targeted most to those who have suffered the most. But broadly, okay. You know, I think your characterisation is fair.
Okay. One wider question on tax, and maybe hear from both witnesses on this. There's an expectation that maybe not in this financial year coming, but in the relatively near future, the UK is going to have to address some deeper questions about tax policy as part of fiscal consolidation. There'll be aspects of that that are wholly reserved. You know, even ideas like replacing council tax and non-domestic rates are being talked about at UK level. Ideas like a national insurance-like social care levy are being talked about again. So do you think Scotland is ready for that wider debate on tax reform, given that we found it impossible even to keep people around the table to talk about council tax in recent years? Are we ready for that wider debate, and shouldn't it be beginning with this budget? Matt, stay with Mary Spurridge first of all, and then come to Liz Cameron.
It's a good question whether we're ready. As you say, we've talked about council tax reform for years and years, and you know, I'm not sure we need another commission or route for whatever to talk about it again to come up with
last thing we need.
Solutions that I think it takes you know, boldness, I suppose, to be able to, and that is within the gift of the government in Scotland and the Parliament to talk about NDR and council tax and think about how we could reform them. Wider issues on tax are obviously more tricky, given that the partial devolution of some taxes and the reserve nature of others, and you can't get away from the interactions between them. So things like how capital gains tax interacts with people who come out of income tax, and you know, the sort of interactions that you have with that, you know, can't be dismissed. And it does make, you know, the approach around income tax a bit more tricky that you have this interaction. And as you say, bold decisions are probably going to have to be made about how we fund social care in the future. And I think that's a conversation that has been, you know, massively highlighted by the pandemic and should shoot up the agenda as a result. But yeah, absolutely. The debate on how to tax land and property in Scotland, and it has again been crystallised a bit by the pandemic, given the NDR, given how many properties in Scotland are now subject of relief, whether it's temporary or permanent, and whether the non-domestic rates system is really fit for purpose. And I see there's another report this morning about town centres and the fact that NDR needs to be reviewed, and whether we can capture the way that businesses operating digitally operate and that sort of thing. I haven't seen any proposals about how that would work, but I definitely think we're ripe for a fresh debate, and I think we have to be a bit bolder about admitting that there'll be some losers from that as well as winners.
Thanks. And maybe just put the same question to Liz Cameron. Is the business community ready for that wider debate on tax policy and the greater role that tax innovation is going to have to play? Because there are times when this question is raised, that the response from the business community seems rarely to raise beyond, we'd quite like to pay less, thank you please very much.
Thank you, Patrick, for that. And yes, you're right, actually, and I think your previous question was, would businesses be more taxed? My initial reaction was no. Let me just expand upon that and answer your question. Are we ready for that debate? Timing's important here, because the pandemic has shone an absolute light on inequality and inequality across all our communities. Business gets that and business understands it. Businesses can contribute towards changing it and doing that in the right way and in the right time. We come out, you know, in 3 weeks' time and said to business, you know, we're going to increase your taxation by X, Y, and Z. You know, right now you have the ability to do that, obviously, and the authority to do it. It would not land well, and it could have quite a detrimental effect right at this point in time in 2021. Are we up for a debate though? And the answer is yes. We've been up for a debate. We've now had nearly 8 years talking about the broken system of non-domestic rates, that and those businesses who are perhaps benefiting from it, that perhaps don't need to be benefiting from it, that do not need that grant support. There's other businesses that do need it. And if we can look at having that realistic debate, because we start a debate that says the tax take cannot be decreased and it must stay stable. That's putting a barrier there straight away on looking at creating a system that works for everyone. And if we look at those costs for business, and that will enable many businesses to be able to give back an awful lot more, whether that's through taxation or whether it's through employing more people, or indeed beginning to raise the salary thresholds of many. Because, you know, we should never ever be in a society where you've got individuals that are working below a particular level of wage and absolutely on the poverty line. That's not what business would be wanting. And so therefore that debate, we'd be up for that debate.
So if it was possible to target a one-off COVID windfall tax at those who've profited from the pandemic, it'd be hard to argue against that, wouldn't it?
Those businesses who've been profiting might argue against it. Let me just say that to you, Patrick. But yes, there have been businesses that have actually benefited because of their business sector, technology, logistics, you know, and we can go on. There's a lot that have actually grown, and that's good, because what they've been able to do is maintain jobs and hopefully recruit and upskill more, especially with our situation with our younger people as well. But, you know, I think that needs to be debated further as to whether those individuals, because, you know, when they make profit or they break even or indeed make a loss, They've got to reinvest that into businesses to be able to employ more people. So we've got to get that balance right, Patrick. I hear where you're coming from, but I think it's important that that debate takes place in the right environment and at the right time.
Thank you, Convener.
Thanks. Anas has a supplementary to this. Anas.
Thank you, Convener. Just a really quick one to Mary. It's probably just following on from Patrick Harvey's question. Patrick, I was talking about a redistributive budget. It seemed to you seem to be suggesting that you didn't think this budget was a redistributive budget or a reform budget. Is that correct? Would you say that's the case?
I think there are elements in the analysis that have been produced alongside the budget which show how it's taken account of equality considerations and looking at addressing poverty in Scotland. But I wouldn't say that it was a very large feature of the budget personally because of some of the issues that we've talked about in terms of the targeting of the things like the council tax fees. So not particularly, no.
Thank you. That was it, Bruce. Thank you, Chair.
On that, before I go to James Kelly, I just wonder, I mean, in terms of tackling poverty and inequality, Mary, I've heard what you've said, but obviously there are spending measures in the budget which hopefully will start to address some of these issues. You know, 68 million being invested in Scottish Child Payment, 53 million in universal free school meals, and a doubling of the investment into tackling child poverty fund, and 3.6 billion now into social security for carers and low incomes. So it's not just about the redistribution element, it's also about the spending element. So what sort of impact do you think these sort of programmes would have in that regard?
Yeah, I mean the money, the extra money that has been given to carers, for example, since it's been devolved, is very welcome for those people. That sort of brings it up to the level of job seekers allowance. So it's sort of correcting, I guess, an imbalance there in the social security system through the carers allowance supplement, which I'm sure is very welcome for those people. The child payment has been seen as a very welcome measure for trying to target resources directly at children in poverty, which all the evidence shows is the most effective way to tackle that. So the Scottish Child Payment should rightly be lauded as an innovative measure that Scotland's been able to introduce to deal with child poverty. Whether it's enough to deal with child poverty to the extent of meeting our statutory obligations that we have is another question. And whether some of the money that was spent on things like the council tax freeze could have been used differently to further those ambitions. I mean, all of these are choices. But I would say, I would agree with you that things like the child payment are innovative and focused at lifting children out of poverty and are evidence-based and have been shown to work. But whether they're enough and how things have been changed by the budget last week, I suppose, as opposed to measures that have already been announced. I was more focusing on what was announced last week rather than the base of spending, which, of course, you pointed out, there are many initiatives there to deal with inequalities and poverty in our society. But I guess we should remember that they have likely been exacerbated by the pandemic. Yeah.
Indeed. Thanks, Mary. James Kelly, please.
Thank you, Convener. Can I turn to the area of employment? There's no doubt that we're in the middle of a jobs crisis, and that's going to deteriorate further. Commentary indicates the potential for, you know, serious job losses in the spring, and the effects of the pandemic are going to be with us until at least 2024. So can I first of all ask Mary Spurridge, given that backdrop, do you feel that there were sufficient measures in the budget to try and deal with the fact that we've got an ongoing jobs crisis, which is going to get worse before it gets better?
I mean, some of the measures obviously that are likely to support employment throughout 2021 aren't within the gift of the Scottish Government. So the furlough scheme has been essential, for example, to keep people attached to their employers. I think any replacement for that scheme if there is to be a replacement after April will obviously be key in trying to reduce the worst impacts of unemployment that we know is coming down the track. The forecasts at the moment assume that the furlough scheme ends at the end of April, and that there's no wage subsidy scheme, as far as I'm aware, after that. I would be surprised if that actually is the reality, and that there isn't some sort of scheme which replaces it, perhaps in the vein of what was going to be proposed after the furlough scheme was going to end in subsequent months at the end of last year. So I would hope and expect that there would be a similar wage subsidy scheme, but that's obviously not within the gift of the Scottish Government, and rather it's in the it'll be, I guess, outlined in the UK Government budget. Whether there's enough to support jobs, Liz has obviously outlined some concerns around the support for bodies like Skills Development Scotland, and focusing on retraining and ensuring that young people have opportunities. So that is an interesting area to explore further. And obviously, the money for enterprise agencies to support businesses could help in supporting jobs, but it does depend on what it's actually spent on and what the focus is and which sectors it's focused on. So it's a difficult question to answer, to be honest, whether there's enough, because it does depend on the detail of how some of these monies are going to be spent.
Okay, thanks for that. If I can turn to Liz Cameron. In response to Murdo Fraser, you discussed the need for a proper economic plan, Liz, and in your submission, you gave some commentary in terms of the sectors affected. In relation to that economic plan, what are the sectors that are most under threat in terms of loss of employment? And what do you think the key factors in that economic plan have got to be in terms of prioritising the sectors?
Thank you for that. I think the first thing I would say is, in terms of key sectors, it was the ones that actually closed very early, and it was actually the sectors that are all consumer facing, and therefore the lockdowns had immediate impact. We know the tourism sector is up there in lies, and it employs a lot of people in Scotland. And from an international perspective, to promote Scotland, it's really quite important that we really do more, an awful lot more, to help the tourism sector and all its supply chains, because it touches manufacturing, it touches events, it touches hospitality, etc. So tourism is a big one. Retailing is the other obvious one that everyone talks about. I think we need to just qualify that there are some aspects of retailing that are doing very, very well. Now, obviously, the ones in city centres are not as well as what they could and should be. But there's also a glimmer of light there in terms of transforming that retailing offering. So I'd like to see a little bit more in focusing on not retailing as a whole sector, but focusing and targeting very clearly, particularly small retailers and independent retailers, as well as those who need it elsewhere. I think we should be focusing on that, looking at reduction of their cost base, might be initially, until they can get back out to trade, and also looking quite closely at how we can actually phase that in that is safe for everyone. So I think that's two key sectors. And there's the other broader sectors in terms of the sole traders, the taxi drivers, some of the construction people who are not able to get back to work right now. An army of individuals that don't fit neatly into sectors. They should be looked at a little bit more closely. So I'd say targeted and focused and look at the detail. In terms of your question about employment support, the best thing that we can do is to try and keep businesses open and to try and keep our employees in jobs. And therefore, that employment support may not only be about grants, although that's helpful. This is about looking at doing everything we can to get our economy opened up again. That will create, if we can phase it in early, safely, because and we've invested a lot of money in making our premises and offices safe, we need that opened up as quickly as possible. That will be better than employment grant support.
Thanks for that. That's me, convener.
Okay, Jim. Can I just ask you a supplementary on that as well, Liz? I think the words you used, an awful lot more for tourism, and obviously my constituency of Stirling as a hugely important industry and sector is tourism. I wonder, could you say a bit more about that and quantify and be a bit more specific about what you mean there?
But support for tourism?
Yeah.
Is that what you're asking, yeah. James?
Yes, a bit more about what quantifying is, being a bit more specific in what you mean, so we can put a record for our purposes of the report.
Okay, well, first of all, we need it to be opened up, and that's point one, safely, and they can do it safely. Second is we need to look at reducing the costs initially as they begin to open up over a 12-month period. So we need to look very closely at non-domestic rates for that issue. That's a big cost for business. We also need to look at any other policy, for instance, tourism levy tax. We are working on the assumption that will be shelved. There's also issues on VAT, which I know is not within the gift of the Scottish Government, but you have influence over the UK Government. So reducing those VAT costs in the way that you did for areas in Aberdeen and elsewhere. So it's that cost base. And if we could have some kind of phased employment support that was going to be declining over a period of time, give us the opportunity to open up the doors. That's just a few examples, and I can give you more. We've actually got a tourism action plan that's quite clear what the tourism sector are looking for, and happy to send you the bullet points on that as well. But it's a cost base, and giving us the time and the breathing space to open up again. I mean, we're sitting with, you know, we talk about grants. You know, these grants, they're not substantial when we look at the costs of keeping hotels open, keeping our bed and breakfasts open, keeping our catering staff together. So I think we need to look closely at where we're spending the money, and are we focusing on those businesses that really need it? And that's why things like discretionary funding is quite important, but the pace of that is too slow, and businesses are actually going out of business because of that pace.
Okay, thanks. Thank you very much, Liz. I was going to go to Tom Arthur, but before I do that, Fulton, is that a supplementary you've got?
Yeah, just a brief supplementary.
Okay, on you go, then I'm going to Tom Arthur.
Thanks. It's just following on, Liz, from your questions, quite specific examples. And something that I've been dealing with on a constituency basis is contact from nightclub and soft play owners. Now, not maybe the most usual alliance of businesses, you might say. However, they're both in quite a unique position in terms of an overall sector, which they've not had any opportunity over the last year to open up. And the people who I've been speaking to in the sector believe quite firmly that their particular sector, and maybe especially the nightclubs, as I think software are hoping something can be done for them, but they don't see themselves opening anytime soon. So I wanted to ask if there was any thoughts you had about supporting these sectors, how they maybe link into the wider economy. And, you know, they did receive a one-off grant, and I asked the Cabinet Secretary about that last week. I would hope that, you know, they would maybe receive another one, but how sustainable is that in the longer term? You know, are we at risk of losing these types of businesses, soft plays and nightclubs? Thanks.
Thank you, Fulton, and absolutely we're in danger of losing, you just mentioned two sectors there when I talked about the other ones that are underneath, not just the tourism and retailing and, you know, the big headline ones. In fact, we went into a partnership with the Soft Play Association, which I didn't realise they had one. We went into lobby government a few months back because they were getting absolutely nothing. They were not in anyone's horizon whatsoever. And when you look at the amount of people they employ in Scotland, the number was either 10, 20, 25,000 people. It's big. It's not just about the employment aspects of that sector. It's also about the support service it gives to others, not just from a perspective, but also that service provision that they provide, much needed in local areas. So we lobbied very hard. We managed to get the government to give them a grant, but that was a one-off. That's not sufficient, and we're going to see more soft play centres. In fact, some are closing as we speak. So I think that to look at that sector, because it is important to our economy, and it's actually usually run by a number of small business owners, medium-sized business owners, employing a lot of staff. So So I think that we need to consider, we've got, I think, I understand we've got about 500 million, which is still remaining unallocated. And I think that's the case in the budget. You know, so therefore, there is funding there. Let's look at what kind of funding we can give to keep those businesses sustainable, ready for that opening. And you know, the only way to do that is by giving cash and getting the cash to them quickly, because whilst they might be closed, they've still got operating costs. They've still got to pay their rent. They've still got to maintain their buildings. They've still got to pay their insurance. It's those other overhead costs that, that we should be looking at, and looking at grants towards that to help them, again, getting out the door quickly. Nightclubs. Nightclubs are one of these areas that it was kind of unknown. It was in there as entertainment. Nightclubs are major parts of, first of all, our centres, major parts of our economy. So again, they should be looked at the same way that the tax, you know, I'm now working with the Scottish Taxi Association because grants were given to them, but you know, again, the design of it wasn't meeting what businesses and drivers need. So we're going back into the Scottish Government next week to review that. So I think that it's these types of sectors that somehow seem to have been continued under that radar, and they're employing thousands and thousands of people. So we need to do everything we've got to enable them to keep going, whether it's next month, whether it's next 3 months, or whatever it is. And that comes back to my point about we need that economic plan and that exit strategy so that we in business can have a hope and a confidence to keep going, because it's hard out here.
Thank you. Thanks, convener.
Tom, please. Tom Arthur.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to Mary and Liz. I'd like to direct my first question to Mary Spurridge, and it's, I would just like to get a sense of what the practical implications are for the government now that we have a, now we have technically reached a Scotland-specific shock. My understanding is that perhaps where there would be is in the waiving of the drawdown limit for the reserve fund. But I also understand there's an opportunity to refinance existing debt within the period of a Scotland-specific fiscal shock. So I wondered if Mary could potentially outline what the actual practical implications are and what options and opportunities there are for the government to be innovative during this period.
Yeah, so the additional flexibilities, as I understand them, I'm sure the Cabinet Secretary and the Fiscal Commission will be able to give you, more details next week, are that there's a higher limit on resource borrowing for forecast error, but it still has to be due to forecast error. So that's enabled a 19 million extra to be borrowed in resource than otherwise would have been the case in the current budget plans. But also that this this limit on drawdowns from the reserve is removed, which given that I think the plans were to kind of draw down the resource maximum from the reserve anyway, given what was in there, but it has allowed more capital to be drawn down from reserve than otherwise would have been the case. And that these flexibilities obviously remain in place for the next 3 financial years, which allows perhaps use of these greater flexibilities in the future in terms of the drawdown for capital, for example. So it does introduce some flexibilities, but those are limited. And on the resource side, my understanding is it all has to be tied back to forecast error. So if there's forecast error that's larger due to the specific economic shock, is the idea that you have that greater provision, but it still has to be evidence that it's due to forecast error. So you can't just, you know, the government can't just choose to draw down more because it would like to spend on day-to-day activities. So that's my understanding of the extra flexibilities it gives. And the idea, of course, was that if there is an asymmetric shock in Scotland, that would give the government extra flexibilities. But I think, as we've discussed in the past, what's been shown over the last few years, the fiscal framework and these issues about relying on forecasts from two different forecasters of very big numbers, is that the overall provisions in the fiscal framework are probably not sufficient for the level of risk that the Scottish budget is operating under. So whilst the slight extra flexibilities are welcome, you know, they still don't give enough flexibility, given the fact that we're you know, relying on these forecasts of income tax and the large changes that can have to the overall funding envelope.
Do you think it would be fair to say one of the primary deficiencies in the Scotland-specific shock aspect of the fiscal framework is a lack of is a failure to increase the envelope for capital borrowing? Because we all understand the importance of capital spend and working way out of an economic shock and the recession. But so my understanding is that the fiscal framework doesn't have that provision. It seems more about just allowing the management of increased volatility around forecasts rather than actually creating provisions which can allow the government to make significant interventions.
I think that's fair, that the focus is really upon the government being able to have a greater coverage for forecast error and also to draw down more of the money it's saved up, whether that's for resource or for capital. But no, it doesn't give provision for economic stimulus, if you like. So, you know, apart from above and beyond the normal capital borrowing powers that are there, you know, it doesn't introduce more flexibilities around that with a focus on Scotland-specific economic stimulus for a Scotland-specific economic shock. So I think that's a fair thing to say. Yes, the focus is on managing forecast error and allowing the government to draw down more from the savings that they've built up in the reserve.
My final question to you, Mary, is just I wonder if you could comment on what lessons can be learned from the timing and phasing of the UK and Scottish budget, because we're clearly in a position right now where the Cabinet Secretary has given an undertaking to extend relief on non-domestic rates for 3 months, but feels unable to go beyond that because we're still waiting on the UK government budget. Do you think there has to be, in the review of the fiscal framework that follows, a broader discussion about how and when the UK government chooses to announce its budget, and perhaps if the UK government is going to be leaving its budget to later, there has to be mechanisms in there to increase flexibility for the Scottish government so we're not left in a position of uncertainty, which in itself feeds into uncertainty in the wider economy, because we can't make announcements, the government can't make announcements that they would wish to do.
I think yes, that's fair. I mean, when the budget was in the autumn, albeit that never really settled down terribly well to being every year, but you know, the idea was that the UK budget would be in the autumn, the BGAs would then be known, and also the UK government announcements which would impact on the block grant, or at least most of them would be broadly known. So the envelope for the block grant and the block grant adjustments would be known, and then the forecast for devolved taxes would be produced, and therefore the envelope would be mostly known. You know, the last few years where we had the budget in March for the UK, you know, it is not ideal. Obviously, last year the sort of the additional flexibilities the Treasury outlined in terms of choosing which PGAs to use is welcome in terms of giving certainty to the budget, but it was further flagged up the issue here when, you know, Kate Forbes wasn't able to commit as she would have done, I imagine, if as I would expect anyway, the UK government do introduce rates relief for these sectors for the next financial year, or at least part of it. I'd be surprised if they didn't. She would obviously have followed suit, and that would have given the certainty to those businesses right away that they were able to actually rely on the fact that this relief would be in place for the whole of the financial year rather than just the first 3 months. Obviously, Kate Forbes has assumed that there will be additional consequentials coming from the UK budget, and the amount she's assumed, given the COVID contingency fund and everything, seems prudent. And, you know, the SFC have also said that seems like a sensible amount to kind of, but it seems maybe quite conservative. These additional uncertainties, you know, don't help, but probably given her assumption of 500 million and the fact that she's funded at the moment within the budget this 180 million or so for the 3 months rate relief, probably means that once the UK government budget's announced that there will be more money there to spend next financial year than we're currently expecting. But I agree, it is not an ideal situation, and you know, devolution has happened in the UK, not just for Scotland, but for the different devolved governments, and the devolved budget processes are a part of that. And I think the UK government could and should show a little bit more cognizance of the fact that these processes exist. Bills need to be passed in devolved parliaments before the start of the financial year, you know, in order to enact the rate resolution and so on. These processes exist within the UK and they should be respected. And part of that is about having certainty over the UK budgetary position as well.
Thank you very much. If I could ask now Dr. Cameron a question around sort of longer term support. A piece of work that I'm involved in another committee, the Social Security Committee, has been looking at how Social Security can support the recovery from COVID, and it quite usefully conceptualises it's having an acute immediate phase and a recovery phase. And if we transpose that to interventions to support business, we have the support through grants, through furlough, through the strategic framework business support fund. But there's also a need to look beyond to recovery, and that's something, you know, Dr. Cameron, you've outlined in your previous remarks about requesting a plan or a roadmap. What I'm keen to get a sense of is what your reflections are on the Scottish Budget's commitment to these longer term issues of recovery through things such as the Young Persons Guarantee or the National Transition Training Fund. Do you think they are sufficient? And what else would business like to see in terms of our longer term support, particularly around skills and also helping businesses to transition to a post-COVID world with a greater uptake perhaps in e-commerce and online and virtual meeting platforms?
Thank you for that, Tom. I think that in actual fact, some of the focus of the budget, particularly in education skills, was really actually pretty good. Because there's an uplift in college funding, there's an uplift in university funding, and then we actually look at the skills agenda in terms of that reskilling we talk about and that upskilling. We had the announcement of the Green Jobs Fund. You know, that's great, but my butt's coming now. I think it's quite important that we work at the detail and the design of what it is we're going to spend that money on. So I think that the transitional funding and the digital funding. Because one of the key areas for skills in transforming businesses that we did not have, particularly small and medium-sized businesses, is around that technology agenda, that skills agenda. That, you know, we've moved a lot. You know, we've moved probably, you know, in a number of weeks into online trading, and it's not just about e-commerce. It's that wider technology and the ability to reach a wider market. We need people to have those skills becoming into our businesses now, and that's the problem. We've got an immediate need that we've been thrust towards very quickly. You could argue perhaps we were not training sufficiently in that area, and I probably would accept that as somebody who runs a small business. It was one of these issues that we must do, but you know, we're firefighting over here. That's replicated across every business we know. So that transformation of business models, if we can actually work with the environment of the social security systems. And work, you know, because what we don't want is individuals that, you know, we want to give them that experience, we want to give them training, we want to give them that development, so we can combine all of this together and put in that recovery plan, here's our training plan, here's our skills plan, and that will be, we've got Martin Logan report, which goes a long way on that side, but we've got other skill needs, you know, we don't have any logistics people, you know, that actually can plan for us, and there's so much talent out there, ready to upskill and reskill and actually train for the jobs that we've got now, because we do have jobs. We've gathered over something like 1,300 jobs through the Kickstart programme in 2 months. That's a positive. And therefore, we will work with the Young Persons Guarantee, with the Developing Young Workforce, but it's joining all that together is the challenge. At times we can be not through real planning, but we can be a bit fragmented. We can actually have an operational skills training plan that's quite clear on the jobs we need now and pace that up. You know, we can't afford to wait 12 months to train someone, whether they're unemployed or in employment. We need, that's where that short, sharp course focus comes in, and experience of working in businesses as well. If we can combine all of that together, I think we've got a fairly good chance of trying to alleviate as far as possible the rise in unemployment that we are going to be seeing. I'd like to see that kind of real innovation coming and real partnership work involving all partners.
Thank you very much, Dr. Cameron. I'd love to continue this discussion, but I'm very much conscious of time, so no further questions can be there.
Thank you.
Good move, Tom. Thank you very much. Alexander Burnett, please.
Thank you, convener, and I note members to my register of interest around construction. I've got two questions, both of them aimed for Mari, really. The first is that there's, the holiday on LBTT thresholds have led to higher revenues. I think in December they were nearly 50% higher than previously. Are we in danger of forgetting our Laffer curve lessons when we remove that holiday? That'd be my first question. And secondly, the OBR showed last week, both the importance of public spending and the construction sector in getting the recovery, the post-pandemic recovery plan underway. These two areas of public spending and construction, they combine in social and affordable homes, but this budget has been cut by 268 million. It was described in housing terms as a huge step backwards. I'd be grateful if you could share your view of what you think of this in economic terms. Thank you.
So your first question was the holiday and the LBTT, the impacts that there might be in removing that. I mean, it's a great question. I think, obviously the resurgence in the housing market that we saw when it was able to be done in the summer and the autumn was although there was a lot of pent-up demand, I think it was unexpectedly buoyant for that period. And across the UK, as well as in Scotland, there's obviously concern that the return to previous tax rates may dampen that enthusiasm. And obviously any tax that goes on transactions will reduce them. That's the nature of tax. Yeah. So it is possible that will impact on the number of transactions we see and therefore things like house prices in Scotland. I suppose I would say that there may be wider issues going on as well as the tax, obviously, if people are starting to see real impacts on their incomes or are feeling more nervous about the future, then they're less likely maybe to make the move or move up on the ladder. So there'll be wider economic considerations around confidence. Any introduction of tax will be another factor in sort of reducing demand slightly in the housing market. Your second question was around social and affordable homes. And obviously, there's a huge discussion to be had here about the way that public sector spending and the construction industry can support the recovery. Whether it's in terms of future programmes, I suppose, of green retrofitting or other things in order to make our buildings more in line with the transition to net zero, or whether it's construction of new and affordable homes that we know Scotland needs. I think obviously there has been a lot of investment in affordable homes over the course of the Parliament, but I think all the evidence would suggest that there was a lot of catching up to kind of do in terms of the number of homes that we need. And this does have the potential to stimulate economic recovery, but so does obviously retrofitting and repair and maintenance of existing homes in terms of the construction sector. With all of this, we have to ask about the capacity we have also in Scotland in the industry. So obviously there'll be a lot of focus on new homes that are built in certain ways in order to help to our transition to net zero. Do we have the skills we need to do that? Will we have to import a lot of the technology to be able to do that in a really green way? Can we build the supply chains in Scotland? These are all opportunities perhaps for the recovery that we can look at in order to make sure that the economic boost we get from these activities is as large as possible. But obviously we need more homes in Scotland and therefore building affordable homes is a sensible part of the economic recovery.
Yeah, thank you for that. I mean, I suppose that's my point. You mentioned both the potential, the risk of the LBT threshold being removed, but also the potential of what affordable homes can do. But actually, the budget's being cut. Does that not in itself give you a concern? I mean, most people were expecting it to rise, if not at least remain steady, given the housing pressures. But yet we've seen a massive drop.
And answering that, Mary, can you just enlighten me as well what the level of capital expenditure limits that applied last financial year compared to this financial year and what that looks like overall, because I can't remember.
My understanding of the overall budget, I don't have all the figures in front of me, Bruce, but is that it's fallen slightly compared to last year, the overall capital allocation. In terms of the affordable housing element itself, I don't have those figures in front of me right now, Bruce, I'm afraid. But I mean, I suppose in all of these questions, it's what is the money being spent on instead? in terms of the economic benefit that can be generated. As I said, there was no doubt that there was sort of catching up to do in terms of the housing need that we have in Scotland. I think a lot of the academic evidence on that is that we haven't caught up all of those sort of the building that we need to do in order to ensure that our outlook for housing need is met. So there is an argument that more should be invested in that, but you know, it's where is that money being invested instead, and you know, what are the different options for stimulating economic recovery? Because if you don't spend it on housing, perhaps it's been spent on something else.
Absolutely. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Alexander. Dean Lockhart, please.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning to our guests. Thanks for joining. My first question is for Liz Cameron, because Liz, you mentioned in a previous answer the potential role the Scottish National Investment Bank could play in the recovery. It does, after all, have a significant budget of between 400 and 500 million available. There's been some debate over whether the bank should stick to its original mandate of long-term mission-based funding, or whether in these exceptional circumstances the bank should get involved in using its budget to save existing businesses which are strategic to the economy, given that we will need these businesses for that longer term economic recovery. Can I get, first of all, Liz Cameron, your views on whether the SNB should be involved in helping existing business survive the pandemic?
Yes, Dean, absolutely. You mentioned we are in exceptional circumstances, in a national disaster here, that I think they need to rebalance. Yes, when the SNB was designed and when it was developed at a time, you know, two, three years ago. You know, fast forward it, I believe it should rebalance its focus, particularly when we're just about to enter a phase where banks are reviewing their debts, they're reviewing loans, they're reviewing overdraft facilities, and their focus is on, you know, rebalancing their balance sheets. So there's going to be a big need for a number of businesses that are absolutely viable that will need that support if we're either to sustain them and or grow them. So I would say an absolute yes to that. And I think one example, Mari just mentioned their construction and housing, and yes, it's how you cut that cake and spend it. You know, this is a perfect example where we should be looking at, you know, economic stimuli that's going to stimulate the economy in terms of construction, not just on the housing market, but also in other areas, perhaps in some of the commercial property away from town centres. You know, we cannot get warehouses right now. Is there something that we could be looking at helping and partnering with some private sector investors in that area as well? So absolutely need to rebalance that.
Thanks very much. And I wonder if Marius Bowich has a view on that from a sort of economic policy perspective. Does it make sense to invest now in order to recover in the longer term?
It makes sense to invest now to support businesses who otherwise would be perfectly viable, yes. But I mean, I suppose we have to remember that the longer term challenges for the Scottish economy haven't gone away either. And it is a balance, considering what role things like grants or reliefs have in order to ensure that businesses who as I say, would be perfectly viable if it wasn't for the situation that we're in, get through to being able to operate normally again. But we do have these longer term challenges in Scotland around net zero, around the productivity challenge, which, as I say, haven't gone away, and many of which may well have been exacerbated during the crisis. So it is a balance, you know, between, I suppose, Scottish government spending on things like grants and so on, and the role of the National Investment Bank and looking at how they can invest to ensure that key anchor businesses, I suppose, are survived through the pandemic, but also, I suppose, with an eye on these longer term problems, which haven't gone away. And we may want to look at the recovery to recover in ways that are consistent with longer term goals around things like net zero or reducing inequalities.
Thanks very much, both very useful answers. I'd like to move on because I believe time's a bit short, and follow up on the discussion about the impact of technology and the move online, because I think that talking about longer term trends, that was a long term trend that suddenly is now happening and has happened over the past 12 months on a very much accelerated basis. My question is enough being done to support business on the move online? Because last month we saw the Digital Boost Fund close 5 hours after it was opened, and that funding was made available on a first-come, first-served basis, as opposed to it being allocated on a merits basis. So I just would like to ask first Liz and then Mari, what more can be done to help business move online? We've mentioned training and we've mentioned skills, but can the Scottish Government directly get involved in helping a number of firms across different sectors accelerate that move online? First of all, Liz Cameron, thank you.
I would say yes, and I think you're right that government actually moved fairly quickly, and in fairness to them, I don't think they realised the extent of the demand for this type of support, and I hope that they've been learned in that regard. So what we need is we need help, and we need, as well as the upskilling of individuals, we need these individuals to be at a level that can come into many of our businesses and help us transform our whole business model in some cases, and help us begin to sell, to trade more online than we've ever done before, and begin to grow our business through that, because we're not going to get that in the domestic market. So we're looking for a rapid opportunity to reach more people across the globe, because we've got fantastic services here. So I think that if we can look at the, I won't call them the consultants, because it's not that, it's about training individuals and getting them into our businesses as quickly as possible. So that's why the short, sharp training and bringing, it's meeting a number of objectives, bringing individuals who are unemployed or about to be unemployed, get them retrained in the particular areas that business needs on the digital agenda. Because we talk about digital, it's got another 40 facets to it. So the specific detail of that needs to be clearly identified, which it we're doing in part, but then actually providing that support, because my hope is that the government will be doing or developing a new digital support package, and I know that it will be oversubscribed as well, so we need to get that right.
Thanks very much. And Mari, I guess the same question to you, but also an additional question in terms of, are you seeing any policy measures being taken by governments elsewhere or organisations that really do address this issue on an accelerated basis?
Oh gosh, nothing is springing to mind, Dean, I'm afraid. But in terms of your question, I mean, obviously government has a role here in terms of infrastructure as well as training. We also need to have the infrastructure to be able to access digital services and to operate digitally as a business. I'm sure as all of us who have struggled with several children on Wi-Fi, as well as us when we're trying to do meetings like this, it can be challenging in order to ensure you have the bandwidth to be able to conduct business appropriately over these digital platforms. So I think infrastructure as well as training has a big role to play here, to ensure that people have this or basic building blocks to be able to operate effectively.
Great, thank you very much. Convener, that's all I had given the time we're at the moment, so back to you.
Thanks, Dean, I'm very grateful to you. Alistair Allen, and thank you.
Thank you very much, Convener. Perhaps a question for Mari Spowage. There's been a lot of debate and discussion for very good reasons about the need that business has for support from the Scottish Government. There hasn't perhaps been the same extent of debate about borrowing power, since we are talking about borrowed money and the implications that there would seem to be that if we do have more support in the future, that means borrowing either by the UK Government or borrowing powers for Scotland. Now, you may be wary about treading into that debate, but should we be having a public debate about borrowing power?
Yeah, I suppose there's two things around borrowing powers. Obviously, as you pointed out, the support that's been given from through the UK government, through things like furlough or bounce back loans, or you know, the, all of the other support measures that haven't come through and aren't consequentials, have been funded by borrowing, as have the stuff that has come through in current consequentials. And obviously Scottish Government have been able to choose how they spend the money that's come through Barnet, but in broad terms it's been spent in the same way, through business grants and support for individuals, which has been administered mostly through local government. So much of this support has been funded through borrowing by the UK government, and broadly that's been seen as the right thing to do to get us through this crisis and to ensure that individuals remain attached to employers who otherwise would be perfectly viable, and that businesses who should survive will survive through the crisis as much as possibly can, although they've been clear that they can't save every business or every job. So I don't think that there's a dispute that that it was the right thing to do, especially given the low cost of borrowing that we currently see. In terms of the debate over borrowing powers for Scotland, I guess there's two things to cover. There's whether the borrowing powers or the flexibilities within the fiscal framework are sufficient, given the level of risk that the Scottish budget is exposed to normally or in a crisis. And I think, as already discussed, it's clear that the provisions in the fiscal framework are not suitable for normal times in terms of the level of risk that the budget is opened up to, in terms of the potential variability in the forecasts and what ends up coming in at the end of the day. So I think it's clear that given the taxes that devolve to the Scottish Parliament, there is not enough flexibility in the fiscal framework at the moment to be able to manage the level of risk. Whether there should be further borrowing powers for the Scottish Government to be able to borrow more money is a debate that's obviously been going on as well, if additional spending was desirable. I guess the point is at the moment that the additional money that's been allocated through the Barnet formula is not on the basis of need. So there's no sort of assessment about the sorts of businesses in Scotland and how much they need. It's come through as a technical thing through the Barnet formula, and it's just as a result of how much has been spent in England, and not in Wales or Northern Ireland or in Scotland is it sort of assessed whether that's how much is needed, and so there may be a broader conversation to be had about whether that's the right way to allocate money in a crisis, but it has worked that way for a long time, so it's obviously quite hard for people to think about moving away from that particular way of doing things. Also because it's unlikely to be in Scotland's benefit, to be frank, in terms of the amount of money that we actually receive. So there is a broader debate to be had over whether more borrowing power should be given to the Scottish Government to borrow for day-to-day spending in a crisis, or just because they feel the need to stimulate the economy. And I think in terms of whether that's likely to be a part of things like the fiscal framework review, I suspect that the Treasury will want to keep that quite focused and are unlikely to grant additional borrowing powers to the Scottish Government, but I may be wrong.
Related to that point, we've heard about how this is a bigger budget than we would normally receive in Scotland, or a bigger allocation. Presumably, history is going to look back on this year and the year before as aberrations. They will look on the graph presumably more like the two First World Wars than a normal discussion about how much money Scotland should receive, if you like, for normal purposes. So I suppose I'm just really asking whether you feel, you've mentioned, of course, how the formula is not based on need anyway, but do you feel that when we talk about this being a big budget allocation, we're really dealing with normal questions here, or is this just purely a reflection of an abnormal situation that really doesn't have any very much bearing on the debate about how much Scotland might need for its purposes?
I think it does highlight some of the issues. It's sort of, you know, the issues are magnified hugely given the amounts of money that have been spent in year, and therefore generating consequentials. You know, they're just massive compared to normal years. So it kind of highlights the issue, I suppose, and that you know, that there isn't sort of a determination of how much is needed in each part of the country. It's just done mechanically. And is that the right way to do things? It's a fair question to ask. You know, we know we have higher levels of public spending in Scotland than the UK average. We know we have higher levels of public spending in Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland than the UK average, and we know that we spend more per head in Scotland than in the north of England, for example, by quite a way. Now, there are some sort of reasons for that in terms of service provision and everything else, but, you know, it's not because of the way it's operated over the years, there hasn't been that look at, you know, what's required. And as I say, I think that would be pretty difficult thing for everybody to accept might happen. I think that it seems unlikely that it'll happen, although there have been more and more calls over the years for it to happen, particularly from people in Wales, for example, who feel that the Barnett formula has not been beneficial to them over the years.
I suppose where my questions are leading up to that, maybe a question for Dr. Cameron in the first instance is, do some of these factors really point to the need for the extension of the furlough beyond this spring? It's an open-ended question. I'm not offering a view, but is that something that business feels?
Yes, it is. We absolutely do need an extension of furlough or a replacement of it, a redesign of it, because we can't just keep getting furlough because, and back to Patrick Harvey's comment, somebody's going to have to pay for this spend eventually. Whether that is through, you know, business taxation, whatever, that's a debate that does need to be had. So I think that it's quite important that we look closely at what we are spending the money on in the next 6-9 months. So yes, furlough or model three of furlough possibly, but that's focused on particularly those sectors that really, really need it. And I think that's going to be a choice and a decision that a government at the UK level will make, hopefully influenced by the Scottish Government's view, because Mary mentioned Scotland was already behind the curve pre-pandemic. And although we might get, you know, more per capita spend through Barnett, Scotland needs that actually right, you know, now and in the next 1-2 years. So I think it is important that we continue to phase the support, but be quite clear when, at what point are we going to be able to withdraw it so that businesses can when businesses open, when we start begin to trade, it's viable that we withdraw that level of support and possibly not give it to everyone who's getting it now.
Okay. Thanks very much, Alistair. Very grateful. Can I thank both Mary and Liz for your evidence today? It's been very gratefully received. I'm going to now suspend the meeting for about 5 minutes to allow a change over our witnesses. I propose that we recommence at about 10:41, and I'll indicate in the chat bar when we're ready to restart. I'll see you again in about 5 minutes, colleagues. Thank you. I welcome the second panel to this meeting, and thank you for your written submissions to Roseanne Fower, who is the General Secretary of the STUC, Councillor Gail McGregor, the resource spokesperson at COSLA, Eileen Rowand, who is the Chair of the Local Government Directors of Finance at CIPFA. And the plan is to go straight to questions this morning. And the first question this morning will come to you from Murdo Fraser. Murdo, over to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to our witnesses. I've got a couple of questions, first of all, for COSLA. Maybe I could direct them to Councillor McGregor, and just to save time, I'll maybe just ask them both together and then maybe roll up your answers into one. Looking at the proposed local government settlement, there is a modest increase, 0.9%, in the revenue core budget and no increase in the capital core budget. Now, I'm sure that's welcome to local councils that there is some increase, but what I'm interested to hear from you is, in practical terms, what the impact of that will be, given that cost pressures have continued to rise. So would the settlement mean councils will have more money to spend, or will it mean having to make cutbacks? And perhaps you can give us some practical sense of what that will mean for the average council budget. And my second question, which I'll just ask at the same time, which is related to that, is in connection with the issue of the proposed council tax freeze. The Scottish Government has proposed £90 million to local councils, which would be equivalent to a 3% rise in the council tax if councils agree to freeze council tax for the coming year. And again, I'd be interested just to get your take on that and what the impact that will be on council budgets.
Thank you, Murdo. Very good questions. I think when we heard the Cabinet Secretary's announcement on Thursday, on the surface, it seemed a very good budget. An additional £500 million for councils to spend is obviously very welcome. But when you start to cut down through the detail, and as you say, you actually claw back to having only an additional £95 million, which represents 0.9% of the budget, it clearly falls very short of COSLA's asks. As you'll appreciate, we've been dealing with cuts to budgets for a number of years now, so we were already starting from a much lower base. And I think it would be very fair to say that we've seen increases in the Scottish budget in recent years, but we've seen decreases in local government's budget. So, for example, 7 years ago, local government's budget represented 34% of the totality of the Scottish Bloc grant. 7 years on, it's only 30%. So we're seeing increasing declines over the years, which are obviously having an impact on our basic core budget, which in turn has an impact on the services that we can provide. So I think just a few examples, the 0.9% increase, £95 million, will only go less than halfway towards paying for an uplift in pay. The pay policy that was announced last week, if we were to even just match that, would cost £205 million. So the £95 million wouldn't even cover the most modest of pay increases. Obviously, we're continuing to deliver services as we have been. We still have business as usual, as well as COVID pressures. So if we don't, not seeing a significant increase that matches the Scottish budget, Scottish Government's budget increase, will obviously have a massive impact on things like how we can develop adult social care, as I say, pay negotiations, which will be coming up fairly soon as well. So it will have an enormous pressure on councils' budgets going forward. In respect to the council tax, it's slightly frustrating that, again, a 0.9% or £90 million figure in an £11.6 billion budget became the headlines last week rather than the actual services that we're providing to our communities. And I think COSLA's long-held view, as you'll be aware, is that there shouldn't be a cap on council tax at all. It's absolutely a local tax. Now, the suggestion of compensation for councils is obviously a political one, and that's a decision that Ms Forbes has made. I think council leaders will find it very difficult not to take that compensation now and impose a freeze. But I think it's fair to say that leaders understand their communities and the pressures on households at the moment, and would probably have applied fair prudence anyway. And our position would be that if there is £90 million, is it going to be sufficient to cover the shortfall? And if it's not sufficient, we will need to go back to government and ask for more. Is it baselined into the budget? Because obviously, if we don't put council tax up this year, it artificially keeps the base low, which means that we may need to double it to 6% next year, which would have an impact on households as well. And I think my final comment on that would be, I can't imagine the Cabinet Secretary for Finance being overly enamoured if the UK government were trying to interfere in Scottish tax policy. And this is very much a local tax, should have been left to leaders make that decision. And if there was additional funding to cover that, that should have been in our basic settlement in the first instance, instead of, as I say, a £90 million headline figure, which was very political. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I mean, that answer covers a wide range of topics, and I'm sure other members will want to come in and pursue some of these issues further. But I wonder if I can specifically follow up on the question of public sector pay policy and perhaps bring in Roseanne at this point before I come back to yourself, Gail. I mean, given what Councillor McGregor has said, can I ask what the STUC view is on, first of all, the Scottish Government's overall approach to pay policy, and secondly, the question of affordability for local government staff within the settlement that's being offered in terms of this budget?
Thanks. I have to say that we share Causeless concerns, answering your second part first, that the envelope that's been given to local government, which of course needs to be able to cover the forthcoming pay negotiations, falls far short of what our affiliates' aspirations are going to be in those negotiations. And the fact that it falls far short of the benchmark that the government themselves have put out in terms of their own pay policy, I think stores up real problems for those negotiations ahead. We have to remember that local government workers have been absolutely key to protecting our society throughout this lockdown, and many of them are on very poor rates of pay, not least workers within the social care sector. And I'll maybe say more about that later, because I think there is a particular case for looking at the pay levels of social care workers and actually recognising their particular skill set in the light of this pandemic, and actually sorting out what has been for a long time a systemic inequality within pay structures and how that particular area of work is valued. But if we look at the public sector pay policy overall, I think the one aspect of it we would welcome is the fact that there is a weighting there that favours low paid workers. However, it doesn't go far enough. The money that's set out there, we've got up to at least 3% for those under 25k that the £750 weighting delivers. But you have to remember how many local government public sector workers right across the public sector earn between that 25 and 36. So, within that area, you're talking about your social workers, you're talking about nurses, you're talking about a whole primary teachers, a whole range of, skilled professionals that have been working extremely hard, going above and beyond throughout this pandemic. And we need to remember that for all the talk of the Scottish Government about making sure that we put money, not agreeing with the UK government's pay freeze, which we fully welcomed, and the need to put money into public sector workers' pockets as an economic stimulus mechanism, this really fails to deliver on that when you start to look at, the amount of workers who are really not going to see much of a pay rise at all. And, around half of essential workers in Scotland have a partner who is a non-essential worker. So we're talking about families that have been going through months of, partners losing their jobs. We're talking about families with people on 80% pay and furlough schemes, a whole range of economic harms that families are trying to be resilient and get through in this period, particularly lower paid workers. And when you look at the amount of our key workers and essential workers that are on low pay, then this was an opportunity for the Scottish Government to really do something quite significant to support working families and make sure that we were putting some liquidity into our working class communities through public sector pay policy. And I think this has failed to do that.
Okay, thank you very much, Roseanne. Maybe just go back very quickly to Councillor McGregor, given you know, you've heard what STUC have just said there, and without wanting to in any way undermine your pay negotiations with the trade unions, Councillor McGregor, I mean, perhaps you could just say how challenging do you think it will be for local councils and COSLA to try and reach agreement on this, given the overall sentiment that we see here, and given you know the requests we've seen from the STUC for more pay for council staff.
Firstly, I would echo the points made around the tremendous work that our workforce have done over the past year. They've been absolutely pivotal in our communities, and much credit to them. They've picked up the bat and they've run every single time that we've asked them to, and are continuing to do so through business grants and home care and the like. So we cannot undervalue our local government staff. As you say, I'm about to enter some quite sensitive pay negotiations at a time where the workforce is feeling a bit wearied and a bit underappreciated. And that is going to make things incredibly challenging when we only have a 0.9% uplift in our own budget. I think the key thing for us is that our workforce is disproportionately in that £25,000 or below bracket, so it will have a disproportionate impact on budgets that are set aside for pay, and we have to consider that. We need to understand we have a policy of parity at the moment, and this splits us away from our policy of parity, where all members of the workforce should get the same. I think we all completely understand the need to give higher reward to those on the lower end of the pay scale. There's no question of that, and the living wage and the uplift in the living wage will help with that as well. But I think at the moment the challenge will be that for every 1% award that we give, it will cost in the region of £90 million. And as I say, the Scottish Government's public pay policy alone will cost £205 million. Now, for us to reach a reasonable settlement with the unions, we will need to see an increase in our core budget to enable us to do that. And without that additional funding, to give them a decent reward will then have impacts within other areas of the council and potentially a cut to services. And what we don't want to do is lose the crucial services within our communities. And as Ros has said, the impact that within our economy of people being employed and being able to go out and spend. So the last thing we want to see is job losses. But the reality is that if we don't get sufficient funding to cover a reasonable pay award, we will be looking at either cuts to services or cutbacks in staff, which would be a shame.
Thank you.
Thanks, Margot. That's his final question. Fulton McGregor, please.
Hey, thanks, convener. And good morning, panel. I suppose before I start, I'll declare an interest as a previous local authority councillor in North Lanarkshire and a social worker, a previous social worker working in South Lanarkshire. My first question is quite a general one. You know, we know that this year has been like no other, and in many ways, the forum book is thrown out the window. So I wanted to ask a wee bit about if there's any analysis been done about the overall impact on councils. You know, for example, it strikes me that, you know, there's many services that haven't run this year, you know, gyms and swimming pools and the like. Many staff been on furlough overall. There's been a lot of support put in from the Scottish Government for businesses, which I know the council have administered, but the money has came directly from the Scottish Government. So you've got that on one side of the equation. And on the other side, you've got, you know, new services being needed, emergency responses being needed, and the obvious loss of income. So I'm just wondering, how does that balance out? You know, has there been any analysis done yet? Are councils at the stage yet where they're looking at how that's worked out? Has there been savings in some areas, not in others? And what's the overall picture looking like? And if perhaps I could direct the question at Councillor McGregor in the first case, which sounds really weird saying, by the way, Councillor McGregor, because it's to be, but to yourself, Councillor Gail McGregor.
Thank you, Fulton. I think I'll defer to Eileen because she's absolutely on the coalface with this one, working on the figures and the impacts on councils.
Okay.
Thank you. So we did a cost collection exercise back September, October. And at that point, we anticipated that the impact of COVID within this financial year was £767 million. Now, that's obviously us forecasting us actually getting back a little bit more to normal. We know that hasn't happened, so I anticipate that the costs will increase significantly. And when I say costs, it's not just costs, because we anticipate roughly half of that to be loss of income. So it has had a significant impact. There has been savings, but what I would say is these have been around the margins. So we've saved on things initially, such as travel, energy, although we know now, obviously, with schools reopening, that was then became an area of pressure. So it has really been very challenging for councils. And we were in a position where there had been funding announced to deal with that of around about 400,000. So it still left a significant gap. So councils are obviously looking at what they can do to address that gap, and there's a number of means that we have been exploring, but we're still not in a balanced position on that. So that's the financial position. What I would say on the impact of services, it's been vast. So you know, we've had to, real pressures on things like home care, homelessness, our trade and standards staff, you know, setting up the community hubs, what we've had to do in communities, providing support on food. Our environmental officers have been under severe pressure. We've worked very closely with Business Gateway as well, trying to provide support to businesses. Obviously, the schools, there's been significant work done there, and a lot of pressure on
Okay, we might have lost Eileen here broadcasting. In which case, Fulton, is that your, if she comes back in, we'll let her finish. Is that your final question, or what, you got another question?
I've actually got a few other lines of questioning here, Bruce, if that's okay. I mean, I think I'd heard...
Sorry, Fulton, you say a few other. You didn't mean you're going to have two or three more questions.
I've got a couple of questions here. I'm obviously at your discretion, convener.
No, a couple of questions, that's fine. On you go.
Okay, thanks a lot for that. I got the gist of the response here, and I think it was helpful to put it in that context, because that is something that obviously I think people are thinking about, how has the pandemic impacted councils and other bodies. I want to just put on record as well my own personal thanks to workers and council workers in North Lanarkshire who have been absolutely fantastic during the pandemic. I wanted to ask about the two areas where there's support from the Scottish Government in terms of trying to make up some of the funding. So one's the £90 million council tax, which has already been referred to, and also the £200 million loss of income through the pandemic. So I wanted to ask, perhaps it will be Councillor McGregor this time, if Eileen's still off, if you think these are sufficient. I know you've already commented on the £90 million for council tax, and that you feel that was a political decision. But removing that aside, do you think that that's something that councils are likely to take up in order to protect their communities? And also, how do you think that the £200 million might link in with a possible bounce back if the economy recovers? And what I mean by that is maybe more folk will start going to the gym or other leisure facilities because they've not been for a year, or maybe people will put in planning applications for things that they've not done, etc. They're just maybe basic examples. Yeah, I apologise for that. So I'm wondering if I can get some thoughts on that line of questioning.
Yeah, not a problem. Thank you very much. I think in respect of the £90 million, we're obviously doing some work with the 32 councils now to establish what their individual council figure would be to cover their proportion of applying a freeze. If it goes north of 90 million, I will expect the Cabinet Secretary to put some additional funding on the table to cover that. But as I said earlier on in my answer to Murdo, that would also be required to be baselined into this year's budget so it doesn't have an impact on next year. In respect of whether councils are going to do it or not, I'm not going to preempt what 32 council leaders are planning to do. It's more than my job's worth. But I think they truly understand the pressure that's on individual households in our communities. We have the council tax reduction scheme, but an awful lot of people at the moment, as you'll appreciate, are just above that limit and it doesn't apply to them, but they're still seeing household pressures. So it'll be down to each individual council and their own individual circumstances, where they're sitting with reserves, etc., to determine whether they take up that offer or not. I think politically it will be very difficult for them not to, because the announcement has been made that the government will cover a shortfall if we apply a freeze. The big question is it going to be sufficient funding? I think in respect to the loss of income, we know that we're still in the region of about £120 million short on the totality of what we know is our current loss of income, or of it being fully funded. And leaders have been very, very clear that I have to go back to the Cabinet Secretary and have further discussion with her around lifting that figure higher. So the £110 million extra was very welcome, no question of that, absolutely. But it still falls short of the absolute loss of income figure that we believe will be applied. And again, as you'll appreciate, you know, when we were doing these cost collection exercises and loss of income exercises last year, we thought we would be further through the route map than we are now. So we're sitting in February, our community centres haven't reopened, our leisure centres haven't reopened. People are not parking in the centre of Edinburgh to get a parking ticket. You know, and so all of those loss of income are not lifting yet, and we don't know where we're going to be in a few months' time. But I think your point around economic recovery and individuals when they are released back out into the community and wanting to go to gyms and you know, utilise facilities will make councils really focus on what communities need. And when we do reopen and get those facilities up and running, we need to ensure that we have appropriate staffing and service for the communities. So we're not quite sure where we're going to be in a few months' time, but we'll keep tracking it and keep discussing it with government.
Yeah, thanks. I think that was very helpful. Bruce, I'll just finish with one final question there then, because I'm conscious of time. I just wanted some comments on the two specific areas of the £59 million expansion into childcare and the £72.6 million for health and social care. Can I have some thoughts on that, how you think that has been received at a local authority level, and you know, do you see any gaps there in this, or do you feel these are good settlements, and perhaps also you know, how much of that may be required to spend on the workforce for each sector? We already heard a wee bit about the, you know, I know you're in negotiations just now and can't comment too much on that, but perhaps I think we would all agree that social care workforce and other workers, you know, do deserve an increase, and maybe comment on that too. Thanks. And that will be me, Bruce. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Phil.
Thank you. If Eileen's back online, I think it would be best if she answered those.
I think she is back online. Yeah.
Thank you.
Hi.
Yeah. Apologies for that. So the £59 million, it's for the expansion of childcare. So it's a commitment that's been made. So although it's additional funding, the costs are already committed. The £72 million for social care, that's in relation of specifics again for living wage, the Carers Act, full implementation and operating of free personal care. So what I would say, you know, these sums of money are welcome. But certainly when you're looking at social care and you're looking at the pressures, the demand pressures within social care and the need to move people out of a hospital setting and have more care at home, there's real pressures there. So obviously we'd be looking for further funding for these areas. And as Gail's already said, when you look at this in the context of not enough funding to cover the pay policy, it will be really challenging for councils next year.
Okay, thank you. Suzanne, I think you wanted to come in with a supplementary, Suzanne.
Yes, I just wanted to come in on that issue of the social care workforce and the budgetary projections that have been set out for them in this draft budget. We're actually really concerned that, you know, given the Scottish Government's commitment to look at a national care service, we're imminently awaiting the outcome of the Feely report into that review. And we've also already had the Fair Work Conventions report that showed there was a need to really look at you know, better pay, better standards, better training right across the care sector, and to look at fair work as a key issue across the care sector. So, you know, we have a range of aspirations for social care workers, sectoral collective bargaining, a pay that properly recognises the highly skilled work that they do. And this budget does nothing to plan to be doing any spending on any of that. So that gives us real cause for concern, given the government have made quite a lot of big promises to look at social care, to look at valuing that workforce. And I think really the reality of this budget is not matching the rhetoric around social care. So we definitely want to see more investment going into making provision for a really significant settlement for social care workers, so that we can start to change the face of how social care works in Scotland.
Thank you, Roseanne. Patrick Harvey, please.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to our witnesses. First of all, can I just mentioned that in the last panel, I cited one figure of £2,000 in relation to the public sector pay policy. I'd followed the link to the previous year's policy, so just to correct that for the record. But can I start with Roseanne Foyer and put the same questions that I put to the first panel around the progressivity or otherwise of this budget? We know that the economic impact of COVID has been unequal. People with lowest incomes, precarious incomes, insecure housing have suffered the most. There are people whose incomes have been protected and whose expenditure has gone down. So that unequal impact, there's a case for using the budget to try and redistribute some of that and achieve a more progressive outcome. The witness from Mary Sparrows from the Fraser of Allender struggled to identify anything in the budget that would achieve that kind of progressive outcome, compared with relatively minor things moving away from progressivity, like the council tax freeze, income tax thresholds, and the public sector pay policy. So, Roseanne Foyer, first of all, can I ask, do you feel that there is anything, not enough, nothing at all in this budget on progressivity in trying to redistribute some of the economic impact of that's already been felt through COVID?
Well, thank you for putting this question to me, Patrick. We do have quite strong opinions on this, as you can imagine. The distribution within this budget, I think, actually is quite regressive. And you know, we are actually quite concerned that, you know, we're talking about Scotland being a country that already had a very deep poverty pandemic before coronavirus hit us. You know, we had, and you can point to symptoms of that, like the highest drug death rates in Europe, like the record levels of in-work poverty, and like the unacceptably high levels of child poverty across our country, as being areas that require urgent attention to really reduce the inequalities in our society. And we see very little within this budget that starts to do that. I think I mentioned earlier the pay policy, and you know, the fact that there was some weighting in there that upped the pay for the lowest paid workers. So you would have to give credit where it's due for that, but it's simply not enough. So it's the right rhetoric, it's the right direction, but it's not enough to make the sort of significant difference to people's pocket. The council tax freeze for us is very concerning. You know, not only does it undermine local government's ability to act in the way necessary for local communities and have that autonomy to make their own decisions around the taxes that they raise, but it doesn't really help the very lowest paid in those communities who will be covered already by measures to reduce their council tax. If you start to look at what is in effect a tax break for higher earners, that seems completely out of step with the Scottish Government's stated priorities on an inclusive economy. And you know, even if we start to look at the tax breaks for business and the business rates, yes, we absolutely agree that, you know, we have to save jobs and do everything we can to protect businesses and help them get through this. But we would probably question whether that sort of blanket tax break to all businesses is actually, you know, the sort of support that's going to get the best outcomes. So as you correctly stated earlier, there are some businesses that are actually doing very well throughout this pandemic, and it should be questioned whether they need additional support of that type at this time. But also, you know, we would like to see tax being used more as a tool to help support Fair Work and help create the sort of social changes that the Scottish Government tell us they are committed to. So if we're going to be a world leader in Fair Work, we have to start using taxation policy to influence better behaviour from employers. So things like, you know, Fair Work tax supplements, like connecting our support to business, to actual, you know, it's not just jobs at any cost or any sort of jobs. We need good jobs, sustainable jobs, and jobs that have good paying conditions. We've actually learned in this pandemic that bad work kills. You know, work that has no sick pay attached to it, that doesn't have good terms and conditions of employment, that is precarious, is exactly the sort of reason that people have found it hard to follow some of the restrictions in order to save lives and protect us all from this virus. So, you know, some very serious problems in our economy have been highlighted, and we should be using our taxation policy and support for business to actually influence the sort of type of quality of work that individuals are able to be employed on. And we should be giving, you know, better rewards to better employers. It's as simple as that.
Thank you. Can I just check then, is the STUC promoting any specific changes, looking at how much could be saved by, you know, targeting the non-domestic rates changes at those who genuinely need support and not at a blanket measure, or, you know, not pursuing the council tax freeze? Is there a costed proposal for a different way of having whether it's a more progressive pay policy or, you know, any of the other things that you've mentioned?
Well, what I would say to you is that the outlay of the 185 million for business rates, and you know, the Fraser of Allender Institute, I think, you know, said that the 500 million within the budget that was a very conservative estimate, you know, of what might come back from the UK budget. So, you know, we also would expect that there will be significantly more money coming the Scottish Government's way once the UK budget comes out, because there will be a need for further, you know, support going forward, and we would certainly hope the UK will give that. And at that point, we would like to see the Scottish Government look again at the public sector pay settlement, because, you know, more than half of public sector workers are women. More than half of public sector workers are, and you heard from Cosla there, you know, we're talking about some very low paid workers. And all the evidence shows that low-paid workers and women workers, when you put money in their pockets, they go out and spend it on their families, they spend it in their local communities. That helps to kickstart the economy and regrow the economy and build wealth in communities. So for us, putting that sort of investment into public sector pay can actually create a very good you know, economic impact that we really need to get things moving. And, you know, each additional 1%, we've costed that, and I think SPICE confirmed that as being about £150 million. So it does give some food for thought that if they're going to recoup that £185 million, there could be a serious look at, you know, perhaps upping the settlement on public sector pay and really thinking about putting some money into lower paid, hardworking families' pockets at this very, very crucial time.
Thank you. Can I put the same question to Gail McGregor then around progressivity and maybe ask Gail to focus on the council tax issue in particular? You know, £90 million allocated to achieve a council tax freeze in the coming financial year. Is that, you know, fully funded? Is £90 million enough to match councils' immediate the hit that they would take for their revenues in that first year? Is there a longer term danger of taking this approach that we shrink the tax base and that it's harder for councils to make up ground in subsequent years, and we lock ourselves into yet another cycle of long-term council tax freezes? And would there be a better use of resources from council's point of view for this money rather than just saving money that will mostly be saved by people in very big houses?
Thank you, Patrick. I think I covered some of that earlier on, but I'll just very briefly repeat. Obviously, the £90 million, if it's not sufficient, we will request more. And as I say, we're gathering that information at the moment. I think the difficulty going forward is that if we freeze it this year, as I've said, it artificially reduces the base, which causes problems going forward into future years. I think council tax is a much wider discussion to be had, as you're very aware. We did have a working group that was looking at a replacement for council tax prior to COVID, which has had to halt its work. But I would hope through our fiscal framework work going forward that we will be able to bring that working group back into operation and look at the longer sustainability of local taxation in its totality. So we're dealing with a very difficult time at the moment where we're all just trying to find solutions to get us through this COVID pandemic. But we need to start to do that longer term work again to ensure that we have a good, robust fiscal framework going forward.
Thank you. And final question to either witness, if they want to comment on this, is about the process. You know, we've obviously got this cart before horse process again, where the councils are setting their budget, then the Scottish Government, then the UK Government. We're now going to have a very brief window of opportunity between the UK budget and the final stage three process, the last chance for amendments to the Scottish budget. It make me little difference whether we use stage three amendments or let the government do in-year budget revisions. It might make little difference to internal Scottish Government budgeting between one department and another, but will it make a big difference for other bodies, councils and others, that are funded by the Scottish Government? Is there a strong reason for saying we should be using that stage three amendment process, or would in-year budget revisions later in the year to take account of extra resources available from the UK budget, would that later process be adequate? Would there be any harm caused?
I'm quite happy to very, very briefly pick up on that, Patrick. I think it's a really important question. I think the key thing is that we all appreciate, as I say, that we're in a different kind of budget round this year. We obviously had a delay to the budget last year because of the general election, but the problems are very similar. The sooner that councils can understand what their budgets are going to be moving forward, the sooner they can begin to plan. And I think any uncertainty around budgets makes things incredibly challenging. So I get your point. We're now in that second negotiation phase. To be fair to Ms Forbes, I think that there's a lot more information to come following the UK government budget, and hopefully there will be an additional flow of funding to Scotland as a consequence. And within that process, then we will look to see, hopefully, additionality going into local government. So we will need some in-year revisions. I think there's no question of that. But I think stability for councils and certainty as best we can in this current climate as soon as possible is of benefit to councils. Some councils may decouple their council tax from their main budget. As you know, legally, all we have to do is set council tax by the 12th of March. So councils could continue on their current budget process, but wait until after stage three to finalise their budgets, as long as they set their council tax separately. But that will be down to individual councils to make that decision.
Thank you. I'm not sure if Rose Foyer wants to comment on that same question, but that was the last one from me.
Thanks, Martin. You've got a short comment to make, Roseanne?
Just really to say that I would actually agree with the. I think it undoubtedly makes it harder for organisations to plan. Just the whole way things are set up, and I was very struck by the Fraser of Allender's comments earlier around that just the lack of respect for our systems. It's well known that this is how Scotland has to reach its budget, and we really shouldn't be placed in a position where we have to, you know, produce a draft budget not knowing what the UK government's budget outcomes are. And I appreciate we're in unprecedented times, however, this is not the first time we've been placed in this position. So I think that alignment of things and just that respect for devolution is a, you know, needs to be questioned and looked into.
Okay, thanks. Listen, folks, I'm very conscious of time here, and that and depends how many people still want to ask questions. I've got three at the moment, but there's more than that. We're going to come really hard up against the hammer, and I need to really ask for both questions and answers to be a bit tighter, please. So with that being said, Alexander Burnett, that wasn't particularly directed at you, Alexander.
I'll try and keep it brief as well. There have been a lot of the business support has been channeled. A lot of the funding has been channeled through local authorities. There have been a number of issues around discretionary funds, the criteria around these, topping up them. And now we're actually seeing a lot of casework where people are actually wanting to appeal them, all of which creates a huge amount of work for finance teams. And just take this opportunity to commend council teams across Scotland, and particularly Aberdeenshire, whose correspondence I see a lot of this work. My question is, councils in England were given COVID money in a general tranche. How much harder is the drip feeding approach in Scotland impacted the councils, and particularly your budget planning and your team's ability to do both at the same time? Yeah, it's to Eileen, sorry.
Yeah, so it has been a challenge, the way that we've received quite a lot of funding. So I think our submission referred to over 30 different pots, and with those pots comes different reporting requirements and bureaucracy. So I think that has been recognised, and I would hope going forward that it will be, there'll be a change in approach. I have been in discussions with my colleagues in England, and I know they have received tranches of income, which have had less reporting requirements. So it has been a challenge, and it's at a time when finance teams are busy trying to prepare for the budget. So I'm hopeful that that will change going forward, and I have probably a plea for myself to make sure that that does happen.
Thank you. Maybe just to Roseanne, how feedback from your members, how have they found administering these funds, these multiple funds, whilst trying to contribute to the budget process?
I think just I will keep this answer brief, but I think that, you know, certainly there have been a range of extra duties placed on local government workers, and you know that has been. There's been, you know, staff teams have had to be redistributed and put very quickly onto other areas of work. There has been, you know, a whole range of changes in systems that have been very fast, and you know, work that's had to be reallocated, and workers have bent over backwards to assist with that process. And you know, we want to see that recognised, and I'll leave it at that.
Thank you very much. That's all, convener.
Thank you, Alexander. John Mason, please.
Thanks, convener. Maybe if I can start with COSLA. I mean, you've made the point, you've made it before, that local government funding has not gone up in line with Scottish government funding, and that is because we've given more to the NHS, because the NHS and local government are the two big spenders. So, I mean, is your basic argument, to cut to the chase, that we should be giving less to the NHS and more to local government?
Sorry, you've asked me this question before in this committee, John. Absolutely not. There's no question of that. I think what we need to appreciate is that councils are the scaffolding that hold up health and social care, and our role within communities, how we can prevent people having to end up in hospital, and how we can ensure that people are supported so they don't need to go into acute care. So I don't think it's about taking money from NHS. It's about how we can assist the NHS and the wider health goals within our community structures to ensure that, that our communities are helped as best we can. So it's not about transferring the money, it's about how we all work collaboratively under our integrated joint boards and health and social care partnerships to ensure that the money is spent as best as it can be.
Yeah, I mean, I accept I had asked you that question before, so thank you for that. I mean, I'm very sympathetic to local government. I was a councillor myself for 10 years. But I mean, if you're asking for more money, it has to come from somewhere. And if it's not coming from the NHS, is Cosla arguing that we should be raising taxes in Scotland generally, income tax and things like that?
No, I think that the less ring fencing and more flexibility around the funding that we do get would help. We're very restricted in what we can spend a huge chunk of our budget on. I just think that we need to keep step. If the Scottish Government has an increase in its budget, we should be seeing an increase in our budget, and it simply hasn't been working that way for a number of years now.
Okay, I mean, that's interesting you mentioned ring fencing, because I remember when I was a councillor, that was one of our bugbears as well. How would you think that would work in practice? Is it practical? Because, I mean, say the 1140 hours for early years, you know, is a kind of national policy. Now, if it's not ring-fenced, does that let each council, you know, not do the 1140 hours? And similarly, I mean, we're giving grants to taxi drivers, for example. If we give more than Dumfries, or Dumfries gives more than Glasgow does, there'll be an outcry. So how do we square that balance?
Eileen wants to come in here because she's dealing with that local level.
Yeah, on you go, Eileen.
Yeah, so probably pick up a couple of points there. I think, you know, what we're keen to deliver on national outcomes, but to be given the autonomy to do that and look at obviously different local circumstances. So, you know, that is our kind of our call to be able to do that, but at the same time deliver on the priorities that are agreed nationally. Going back to the last question about relativity of budget, what I would say is obviously there's significant health consequentials that come, and through the process of dealing with COVID, these have picked up health and social care costs. But I suppose it's recognising that to improve the health and wellbeing of the nation, you know, there's very important council services that contribute to that and deal with inequality, which is at the foundation. So for me, I would be kind of making a plea to look at the use of the health consequentials and looking at a wider use of these in order to improve health and wellbeing.
So, right, that's an interesting point. So if we say got £100 of health consequentials, are you arguing that full 100 should not necessarily go to the NHS because councils are also doing health issues, and so maybe £20 or £30 or something should be going to health in that way?
Yeah, but all I'm saying is to improve the health of the nation, you know, there's things like you have to improve what you do in housing, how you deal with homelessness, you know, and making sure that communities are active, environmental health. There's lots of issues that would improve the health. And I think, you know, if we can look at it on that basis, and a proportion can go, as it is going at the moment, to health and social care from health consequentials, but we perhaps look at that on a wider basis.
That's great, that's helpful. And I think my final question would be to the I find it very helpful, I have to say, you answered Patrick Harvey with some specific figures and where, like 1%, if I understood that correctly, would be 150 million extra cost. So that is good to get that. You also mentioned investment in care, like care homes and so on. Have you got any equivalent figures as to how much money you'd be looking for the care sector?
I think that was you, Roseanne.
Is that for me? Yeah, right. So basically, in terms of the care sector, what is significant to note at the moment is that the money that has been given, you know, that's allocated for workforce is simply to enact the living wage. And I think what we are saying on care is that there needs to be, you know, a real look at the level of skills in that work. There is often a real difficulty in recruitment in that area because, frankly, you can get the same pay or better pay for doing much less difficult and less responsible work. So there's a real need to really look at the level of pay for care workers, social care and residential care workers. And so that is an issue. I don't have the definite postings of what that would cost, but I think, you know, we're looking at significant uplifts. The GMB union has named a figure of £15 an hour for care workers, which gives you an indication of the ballpark that we are talking about, rather than, you know, just simply ensuring that they're all getting the living wage. So, you know, that's a significant change, but you need to remember that that change would not only be great for the service and for, you know, service delivery, service users, and a step change in the whole way care is done. It would also have a significant economic impact in local communities. And just on, sorry, John, I was just going to say, yeah, on the question, Cosla, we need to look at the Scottish Government's ability to enact extra borrowing powers here. There really isn't enough in the budget to cover health, local government needs, and the need to build a proper economic recovery. So, you know, if ever there's a time to be making really urgent arguments around extra borrowing powers for the Scottish Government, the time is now, and the STUC is highly supportive of that.
If I can just finally then, I mean, I'm persuaded that the care home workers and people do need better pay, absolutely. That means higher fees, that means probably a tax increase. So would that be how, I accept the costings haven't been done yet, but is that how the STUC, Unite and so on would see it, that we should be specifically raising income tax for the care sector?
It's not for, we don't have a specific policy about raising income tax for the care sector at this stage, but clearly you're right, it will have to be paid for, and taxation would be one of the means that could be looked at to do that. But I think you have to think about the wider economic impact of raising standards in the care sector. It would take a burden off the NHS, it would create there needs to be a whole root and branch change to the care sector, and I don't want to anticipate what might come out the Feely report. I think we have to do care in a very different way. One of the things that we think in the STUC that should be taken out of the care sector is the profit element, because public money at the moment is ending up in shareholders' pockets, and every single penny of public money that's spent on care, in our view, should be going into the provision and reinvested into the provision of services, the skills and the actual, you know, service that's delivered to service users.
Thanks very much.
Right, can I just follow up on that, Roseanne, because I think everyone would agree about the need to recognise properly people and what the remuneration is. If we don't have these borrowing powers just now, and obviously the Feely report will take a wee bit longer yet, I'm assuming, but we're talking about next year's budget. And if there's a demand for extra money to meet justifiable pay rises, where do we make the changes in the budget to make that happen?
Well, as has already been stated, the £500 million within the budget is one that's been set aside that's seen as a very conservative figure. So we certainly hope to see more consequentials being able to be drawn down by the Scottish Government. So there should be scope to make further changes within this budget. And I would agree with you that, you know, at the moment we don't have the borrowing powers and there could be some very difficult decisions to be made. But I think overall we need to, you know, open up that debate with the UK Government about the need for significant levels of further investment One of the areas that I would agree with actually the Chambers of Commerce on is that the levels of investment at the moment to create the sort of economic stimulus required to kickstart our economy, the pots of money that is all that's really within Scottish Government's gift at the moment are not going to be enough to make that significant difference. So, A, I would be asking Scottish Government to work very closely with UK Government in partnership to look at getting agreement around significant further areas of investment. But I actually think that Scottish Government are the people who are in charge of economic development, and therefore they should be given, you know, it shouldn't be about UK Government coming in and telling us what they're going to invest in. The Scottish Government should be working closely with UK Government to get some additional funding that they can then make decisions on how that additional funding is spent. If we're to have a proper joined up industrial strategy for rebuilding our economy, we're going to need more than the sort of pots of money that the Scottish Government's able to allocate. So we do have to have some of those difficult conversations around following.
Can we continue with that issue of difficult conversations? Because it is difficult, and I accept that, and I hear what you're saying. Are there any areas in the Scottish budget, and as far as I understand, the £500 million is already allocated in the budget.
Yep.
Are there any other areas in the Scottish budget you think should change to enable some of these other priorities to be addressed?
Well, I think we would certainly question whether the £90 million on a council tax freeze could have been better spent elsewhere. I think we would question whether the £50 million that is estimated to have cost for the what is in effect a tax break for higher earners could have been better spent elsewhere. So there are a number of areas where we would question the money that's been spent, and we would probably question whether a blanket rates rebate approach is the right one, or whether, you know, some sort of assessment of who needed it more than others, and those that didn't need it don't get it. So, you know, there is a number of areas where we could have created savings that could have been better invested into, for example, public sector pay.
Okay, that's helpful. Thank you. James Kelly.
Thanks, convener. Just about renamed me there. Two questions, one to each panellist. If we can start with Roseanne Foyer. In terms of your submission, you made the case that the £500 that's been paid to NHS staff should be extended to all key public sector workers. Can you just maybe give the committee a flavour of some of the hardship some of your members and the workers you represent have experienced during the pandemic, which gives merit to the demand that you're making?
Yeah, I mean, I'm happy to. We have obviously a whole range of members that carry out jobs where they have been out, day in, day out, interfacing with the public and looking after people. And they weren't included, you know, in that £500 payment. And I can't explain to you, you know, how that's actually affected morale in a great many cases. But I mean, if you take, you know, an example of perhaps someone like a refuse collector, who, you know, we actually have seen quite a lot of health and safety issues that they've had to face in terms of being out. It's an absolutely essential task that needs to be carried out. And, you know, we're talking about people who are not on great levels of pay. But more importantly than that, when you look at the family units, around half of our essential workers have partners who are in non-essential work, who are facing grave levels of job insecurity. If they happen to have a partner that's been perhaps in the hospitality industry, it's highly likely that they could have either lost their job or spent several months below minimum wage on some sort of furlough scheme if they're lucky. And these things are having a massive effect on people's ability to actually, you know, pay their bills, pay their fuel bills in what has been a winter that is very difficult. So, you know, all of these things mount up for our members and create conditions. And as I said before, we already had a poverty pandemic taking place in Scotland and some very difficult conditions that working class communities live in and work in. So, you know, these things have a huge impact, and that's why we're making the economic case that a significant public sector pay settlement is important. And, you know, it was welcome the fact that we had the £500 payment to health and social care workers, but we have many workers who have been putting themselves and their families at risk day in, day out, going out and doing above and beyond what their job description asks them to do. And, you know, the palpable feeling of being forgotten about for those workers was really high, and, you know, can't be underestimated. So, you know, I think it did create an expectation among those sorts of workers that they would at least get some sort of significant pay settlement. And now when we're looking at what the budget projections are showing, it's not looking like they will.
Thanks for that. I think those are points well made. Turning to Gail McGregor, can I ask about housing? We heard in the previous session concern about cuts to the housing budget. And given what you said at the start about the overall wise you've got in terms of the local government settlement, What does that mean for housing, given that we know that there are real pressures in social housing waiting lists, and that's an area that's of real concern in a lot of communities?
Thank you, James. I think Eileen would be best to answer that.
Yeah, I've not got the detail here on the reductions in housing. I know that there has been reductions in, not in the local government budget, but within the other departmental budget. And obviously, I've not got the detail here, but I've kind of go back to my previous comments about how we deal with inequality and poverty. So obviously, housing is an area that we obviously need to invest in. So it's important that we continue to do that. But as I say, I've not got the detail on that because my focus has been the local government budget.
Okay, thanks for that. That's me, Bruce.
Thank you, James. I'm very grateful. No one else has indicated they wanted to come in. So can I thank all three of you for your good evidence today? And we'll be hearing next week from the Scottish Fiscal Commission and the Cabinet Secretary for Finance. And that will be our opportunity to discuss some of the issues that were raised today. And also during our last session with Kate Forbes and OBR. We have no further public items on our agenda today. I therefore now close this meeting. Wish you all a good day. Thank you.